Hello, everybody. We'll get started in just a second. Let's do a quick audio check. David, how's it going?
It's going great. How are you?
I'm doing good. Kyle, how you doing?
Doing pretty good. Happy to be back in the land of the supposedly free.
All right. So let's go ahead and kick it off. Here we go, folks. Everybody, that's right, it's just me. This is my show now, and I'm running it, and things are definitely going to stay exactly the same. It turns out when you do 31 episodes of a show and pretty much change nothing, it's basically fantastic. So we're just going to be doing more local chat, less Will, more Kyle, more David. How's it going, guys?
It's going great. Yeah, honestly. Have a good day.
Perfect, perfect. So let's just Kyle, tell me about Tokyo. We need to talk about it. Let's just talk about it. You've been to Tokyo for the Olympics. How many medals have you won? Have you won? And how many athletes have you bested in the field of sport? There's a joke in there somewhere.
Yeah. I mean, as you both know, esports made a really big showing at this year's Olympics.
Oh, Jesus.
So. We actually talked about that.
You would probably be Warzone. I'm just trying to picture if you were an esports athlete.
I haven't touched Warzone in like 6 months.
So either
been a really long time.
Or Jedi Knight Outcast.
Yeah, any Star Wars games, KOTOR, yeah. I'm there. Like single player stuff, it's like who can get through like the entire story. I could do that. But yeah, I wouldn't touch like the multiplayer stuff. But Tokyo was cool. As far as the pandemic goes, it didn't really change anything. Stuff just closed earlier. Like
that's interesting.
Stuff wasn't shut down, but it didn't go past 8 p.m. and you couldn't sell alcohol in specific places. But that was really it. I mean, everything else was open. There were a ton of people still walking around. Everyone had masks on. It was pretty cool. I got to see a lot of cool stuff. I did everything on my list. And it was great. I went to the Nintendo store 3 times.
Oh.
Which was interesting. So I went the first time to see it. And there was a bunch of stuff that I wanted to get but had to like ruminate on. Mm-hmm. So I went back the second time like a week later and got they have like these really cool plates, like a plate set you can only get in Japan. And there were a couple other things that like were specific to that location. And then I was like, okay, I'm done. I've done everything that I wanted to do. I got everything that I wanted to get from that store. I'm good. The second to last day, my supervisor saw I had gotten some Legend of Zelda pins, just like the Triforce and then the the Ocarina. And he saw them. I was wearing them on my lanyard and he just like his eyes lit up. And you know, when someone starts talking about something that you know they're really passionate about, it was like that. I was like, well, the second to last day, he was a really cool supervisor. His name was Guy. And he pretty much didn't have any days off. Like he was just. He just worked straight through. So he wasn't sure if he was going to even get a chance to go into Tokyo at all to explore. So I was like, I'll just go to the Nintendo store for him. So like the second or the last day I went before work, grabbed some pins, and they this thing in Japan that everyone does is they have like handkerchiefs or towels for sweat because it's always so freaking hot. So they have a bunch of themed towels like that, just little like hand towels, basically. So I got him one Legend of Zelda themed one and then the same pins that I had and gifted it to him on the last day. He was very happy. So that's why I went to the Nintendo store 3 times. But it also meant that I got to go to the Capcom store, which is right next to it. There's a Shonen Jump store if you're into like the One Piece and stuff like that, which is pretty cool. And then across the hallway from the Nintendo store is a massive Pokemon Center. With a ton of cool stuff.
Nice.
That's awesome. Pretty cool. As far as nerd stuff, that was like, it was all based in this one mall called the Parco, which is in Shibuya. And then I didn't really do too much like other like nerd specific stuff or like video game specific stuff. I went to a lot of temples and parks and just walked. I got an achievement on my Apple Watch. I walked 48 miles.
I was
like
in a
like,
day.
No. So the first two weeks I was there, I was in a soft quarantine. So I couldn't go anywhere other than my hotel, this one convenience store right on the corner called a Lawson's, and then work. So that's okay. All I did for 14 days. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't like go out. I couldn't walk and anything. Once that 2 weeks was up, that's when I was able to go and do whatever I wanted. And they gave us a pass so that we could use all of the trains and subway lines and buses and pretty much any public transport for free for the entire time that we were there. So travel did not cost anything. It was great, nice. Honestly. And yeah, so I did most of my walking in the and exploring in the last like 2.5 weeks, like 3 weeks that I was there. But it was sweet. It was really, really cool. We went to the Sky Tree, which is like the tallest man-made building or man-made structure in Japan. It was great. Yeah, great views. Cool. It's oddly very similar to the One World Trade Center in like its presentation. Like it's just there were certain things. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess that happens with any sort of like, this is a tall structure that's meant for tourism.
Yeah.
But it was really cool. Got some good views. I did not get a chance to go very far out of the city because it just work did not allow for that much time to explore.
Yeah.
The furthest I went was this town called Saitama, specifically this part of the town. I think it was called Tokorozawa, and I had handpicked award-winning green tea and green tea ice cream. Ooh. Which was absolutely delicious. Nice. And delightful. They had it, you know how like we have cones where it's like they're longer? Well, this was more mm-hmm. like a cone that enveloped. It was like circular.
That's kind
of
cool.
So it was kind of like an ice cream sandwich, but with a cone instead of a cookie. Mm-hmm. It was really good. I definitely recommend it. And also, fun fact, that town is where Miyazaki came up with Totoro. And mm-hmm. Like he created this My Neighbor Totoro movie and the character, and the town has an agreement with him that so long as they continue to preserve all these natural spaces within the town, he donates money to them every year. And there's like this thing called the Totoro Fund that people can donate to, and all over the town there's like little references to Totoro, which I thought was really cool.
That's cool.
Is that where the museum is too?
No, I think the museum is somewhere in Tokyo, but we couldn't even go to that because you needed to book in advance.
Yeah, I went the last time I went, like, I just sold out. Where it is.
Yeah, and everything was super limited because of, like we talked about going to Disney, because apparently Disney Sea is, like, the best theme park that Disney has ever done, and they were only letting 5,000 people in a day, and it was sort of a lottery system, and they prefer not to let foreigners in. Just the current mm-hmm. state of things. But yeah. We did the Team Lab stuff, which was like one of the coolest things. We went to Team Lab Borderless. I don't know if you guys know of this.
No, it's
like
what's that?
So it's a modern digital art and installation museum. And it's done by they're called hyper technologists or ultra technologists. It's a ultra technologist art group based in Japan called Team Lab. And they have two different installations, one of which is called Borderless, and it's in Odaiba, which is sort of on the bay. And it's really hard to describe. It's basically an interactive art installation with a bunch of different pieces inside that you can go and interact with. And it's sort of a museum. It's like a Please Touch museum, but with projectors mm-hmm. and interactivity, and you're supposed to that take pictures awesome. Of everything. It's great. I'm not even doing it justice. I'm working on putting together a video for, I took video like every day, and there'll be a significant portion of that video that highlights just the Team Lab stuff. And it's just incredible. I mean, they have, I think it was called the Crystal Cavern or something like that. It's literally a room, like this massive room with these strings of LEDs that come down, but they're all mm-hmm. really close to one another and they light up in formations. And it's just like, cool. it's really, really cool. So if you get a chance, I definitely recommend it. But yeah, that was like Tokyo. Oh yeah. And then the Olympics happened. So that was fun. Yeah. I honestly didn't really see much of the Olympics outside of my job. So mm-hmm. it wasn't even like they were going on.
Yeah, man. It's like, cause I like the Olympics, but I have missed the last several Olympics. Yeah. And I got to see a little bit of this Olympics, but I didn't see most of it. And the number one reason is, in the US, you pretty much have to have NBC or be subscribed to Peacock now. And I don't yep. want to do either of those things. And I don't want to set up an over-the-air antenna to try and pull off the airwave for the local NBC. So I just can't watch it. Pretty much, you just yep. can't watch
That's
it.
That's where I'm at.
and it so sucks.
You're not missing much because NBC consistently has the worst broadcast.
Yeah.
Where it's just like, I know the CBC, the BBC, and a bunch of like the NHK, they air a bunch of the Olympic stuff commercial free. And NBC takes like the opposite approach because they're like, well, people want to see the Olympics in between their commercials. That's what people prefer. It's like they cut a ton of stuff. There's a time delay, obviously, because of the time difference. But the stuff they end up cutting, it's all the other major countries. They only care about American country or American athletes. I'm going to say contestants. It's not a quality broadcast. The stuff they put out for the Americans is quality. But like the way that it's edited and the way that it's produced is just super annoying.
Yeah, I will say the one good thing, though, is during the Olympics, I was down in Florida for like 3 or 4 days. And staying with my sister and her family, and they have cable. And so when I had time, I would just put on cable, and it was like you're exactly right. The primetime NBC cast sucks because part of it is they try and hold back stuff from live to show during that like 8 p.m., 9 p.m. primetime broadcast. But during the day, NBC owns so many channels like Bravo and the Golf Channel and like CNBC, and they just turn all of those into Olympics channels. So I was having so much fun just watching like rugby matches, like not even US rugby matches, just like 2 p.m. replays of rugby matches on like CNBC, and then I'd hop over to like Bravo, and they would have like badminton on, and I'd watch that for an hour or two. So if they do a good job of plastering it all over the place, it's behind a paywall, and that sucks.
Yeah. I should have specified that it's the primetime stuff that's really
primetime sucks.
Terribly done.
Yeah.
But yeah, the fact that, you know, on all these other broadcasters across the world, really, you don't have to pay for anything. It's just on nationally, and most of it is either very limited commercials or commercial free. So it just sucks that it's just like everything about American broadcasting is like shown to how horrible it is compared to, like, I watched the opening ceremonies, NHK, which is the national news in Japan. Think of it like ABC, only not owned by Disney. And it was great. It was all in Japanese, and they actually ended up translating the IOC president, Thomas Bach, who's terrible. I'm not supposed to say that, but and they translated him, his speech, which was in English, into Japanese. So I was like trying to like listen to his speech in English as they're like, it was an interesting experience, but completely unedited, just raw. Like here's what everything is, and very little commentary. I know a lot of people complained about the quality of the American commentary on some of the major sports that people are interested in, and it was just like it was so much better experience. Yeah.
I remember I really like the opening ceremonies, but I've kind of stopped watching them just because it's hard to find a clean version of it online. And then you end up having to watch the
impossible.
Yeah. And then the NBC version is literally just like something's going on. They're like, now this is a reference to pottery, which is from ancient humanity. Look at how they are forming a bowl. It's like, shut up. Just let me watch the art. Don't explain it to me. Okay. It's just, it's so upsetting.
Yeah. I mean, it's literally the one of the biggest shows on the world stage. I don't think they're going to make it too difficult for you to understand what's going on.
Exactly. Like, yeah. I don't need you like talking over it like I'm a kindergartner.
Yeah.
So anyways, just curious, did you happen to play any games at all during your time?
Yeah. So I went to Akihabara, or I'm trying not to sound pretentious when I say things the way I was told to say them.
Wait, so how were you told to say it?
Akihabara.
Really? Because like, I always hear, again, it's always Westerners, but I always hear Akihabara. So well, it's good to hear the correct one. Or is it two different places?
I think there's two different places.
Oh.
There's Akihabara and I don't know. There's a bunch. I literally went to so many different places. Anyway, we went there, and there obviously it's like the land of arcades, and arcades there are very different from arcades here.
They're like so story good
buildings, yeah.
And they're everywhere. I mean, there was one, I think it was called Taito or Taito Games. Yeah. It was like a franchise that was there. We went to that one, and we also went into some other like just sort of local ones that were really cool. I played the original Pong, which I'd never played before,
but
it was
cool.
It was on like, you know, like a CRT. It was great. It was awesome. They had a whole floor dedicated to older games. And then I think in that same arcade there was one I had never seen this before, but it's literally a LAN setup for arcade games. It's like a card game, and the cards have NFC chips, and it was very like what you think of Yu-Gi-Oh almost, but in real life, and you can play other people in other arcades on the same games, just either locally or across the across the entire country. And I thought that was just really, really cool. And so many gacha little things you can try out, little claw machines and stuff. I won a really big Charizard for about 500 yen, which it was like 100 yen per try. And that Charizard would be like $50 at a Pokemon store, and I got it for like $5.
Oh, perfect.
So it was cool. Tokyo is definitely overwhelming at times, but I never thought that it was like too much. It was just like, oh my gosh, there's so much more to experience and see, and it was very exciting. I'd always wanted to go there since I was in middle school, so I was really, really happy to be able to visit.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Definitely want
to
go back.
I definitely.
Tokyo's so fun to visit.
Yeah, I definitely want to. I don't know that I can say back because I didn't go to Tokyo, but I lived in Japan when I was 4, 5, and 6. But the problem was We were in Okinawa, which is one of the offshoot islands. We went to the mainland for a week. I was a kid, so it's not like I could do whatever I wanted. Yeah. My parents didn't have a lot of money, so it's not like we were spending a lot of money. And I always wanted to go in the arcades, but my parents were just like, no, we're not going in the arcade. And I'm just like, I want to. It's a 5-story arcade, you know? So I definitely need to go back to experience it as an adult.
Oh, they have some. Akihabara has some fantastic shops and stuff, too.
Yeah.
Did you go to Mr. Potato while you were there?
No, I went to the Razor store. They have a Razor store there.
Oh, that's new.
Cool. Wait, okay. Razor scooters or like Razor cell phone?
Razor like computers.
Oh, that
Razor peripheral.
There's too many Razors.
Yeah. It was so funny. You said the first one, and I was like, oh yeah, that's a thing. And then you said the second one, I was like, oh yeah, that's a thing too. But we went to the Razor store. We literally were looking for GPUs. We knew we weren't going to find any, but we were just walking through, and it was like, oh, that's green. Oh, that's the Razor store. It was literally like the green that's behind me right now. Like, let's just go in. The entire room was bathed in like green LEDs.
My whole place is a nerd paradise right
there.
I felt like
I should have, it would have been required of me to walk in with like a Gamer Fuel or like a Mountain Dew or something.
I bet the employees at the Razor store like are slowly getting eye damage from just looking at green light the entire day. That sounds awful.
Either of you go to Akihabara again, look for a store called Mr. Potato. You can Google the location, it'll show
I've heard of it.
It's like a 5-story retro game store.
Yeah,
systems you can play on. They have like old games in Japanese, primarily Japanese releases. They have some English international ones. Store is just, it's like walking through a video game history museum. It's super cool.
That's awesome.
You don't buy anything.
I had asked a bunch of people like, hey, if you've been to Tokyo before, if you know of a place that's cool, let me know, because I had a list, and I really wish that like someone had told me about that store now, because I really want to go. I did, and I think I told the Subpixel guys about it, but now I'm speaking about it publicly. I did attempt to visit Kojima Productions. and by attempt to visit, I mean I emailed them asking if they gave tours, which I assumed was no, especially during a pandemic. I got a very nice reply from them. I actually screwed up. Speaks to how badly I need to proofread my own emails. I was talking about the studio, and I said, I'm here for the Olympics. I'd love to visit your studio. And I said studio twice. And the second time I typed it, it auto-corrected to stupid. So it was like, oh, I'd love to visit your stupid, whatever. And then I immediately emailed them back and was like, I'm so sorry, I did not mean to type stupid. And then in the email that they sent back to me, they were like, hi, Kyle. We know you did not mean to type stupid. It is okay. So I was like, thank you.
That's crazy.
Yeah, they do not offer tours, and they said that is always the case regardless of COVID, which is fine. I know that Valve is like one of the weird studios that's like, yeah, you can come, like send Gabe an email, and it's like, we'll give you a tour. Maybe not with COVID, but I know that there's a lot of people who have been like, yeah, let's just do that. So I figured I'd shoot my shot, and it was cool. At least I can say now that I've been in contact with Kojima Productions. So
that's cool. make
Will jealous.
Yeah, one of the things that I mean, okay, look, this is going to be a controversial statement, but one of the things I'm looking forward to, of the many things, when COVID is over, is being able to, like, freely and easily travel again. Because, like,
yeah,
it's starting to open up, but I still have that trepidation where it's like, sure, I can go, but are they going to force me to quarantine for a bit? And or are half the things I want to do going to be closed or restricted? So it's like, we started a travel show 2 months before the pandemic started, and we've still been doing it. We have like 4 or 5 episodes out, which is more than I thought we'd do in the middle of a pandemic. But once it ramps back up and we can start traveling, I'm telling you right now, we're gonna have some crazy travel episodes of Pixel 8. It's gonna be great.
Heck yeah.
David, tell me God, I'm just a fucking mess tonight. You know, normally I'm not this bad. I think I'm just a little bit nervous, not about screwing it up, but I think I kind of want it to be better than Will's. So,
well, isn't helping this second right now. It's not helping you.
I'm going for the pity vote, okay? We're going to have a vote, and I want the pity votes. David, tell me what you've been playing.
Sure. I guess, real quick, I'm still playing Final Fantasy 14.
No,
I'm
not
into...
quick. Not quick. This is a Final Fantasy 14 podcast now.
I've talked about this game at length on this show, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. I am into Heavensward now. It is significantly better than even the base game, I am having a lot of fun with it. I got to play with Ian here along with Will. We did Will's first dungeon. First MMO dungeon like ever, which is wild considering he was subbed to WoW for like years.
I think you caught when he said that every time he goes back to WoW, he creates a new character and he doesn't continue his character.
I hated all of that.
What?
But yeah, so I respect to a tank character for that stream because I don't think Will wanted a tank, which I think was a good idea. So. Did Gunbreaker for that. It seems cool. I've mostly been playing Ninja. Heaven's Ward. It rocks. I'm really enjoying it a lot.
Man,
they hit their stride.
Like, I've heard that, and hearing you say that makes me even more excited because I'm at level 48. I'm very close to the end of the starting story. Well, I don't want to say the starting story, but the first story chunk. And
yeah, you're going to get, just so that you're aware. Yeah. You're going to get to 50, you're going to roll credits once, and you'll be like, cool, I can go to Heavensward. Wrong.
There's like this extra stuff, right, that you have to do.
There's a big chunk of stuff that was post Realm Reborn, but before Heavensward. Basically all their post-game content is part of the main story, which is cool. I like how they did it. But it does take a pretty long time. It's a lot heftier than I thought it was going to be. So you still got a while before Heavensward. But the post-game stuff was also like pretty dang good, so you'll have a good time.
Because that's the crazy thing, is that I'm actually really, really enjoying the story and what's happening. Like, a lot of people act like it's awful, it's terrible, just stomach it, the good stuff is coming, but I'm actually enjoying it, you know?
It's not bad, it's just not great, in my opinion, that first stuff.
I would agree.
And Heavensward, so far for me, there was a character who I was like, man, you were not interesting in the base game. But in Heaven's Ward, you are the goat. You are my best friend. I love you.
It's crazy because, like, I think my standards were so low because I don't typically like MMOs. And one of the things is it feels like they don't really do a good job of presenting story. And I'm not saying 14 does it better, but for some reason I am actually invested in this story, even though the cutscenes still have that like jank where it's like, let's wait 2 seconds between lines and all this stuff. But like
that stuff also gets better in Heaven's
War. Oh, I can't see all this is just like, and then the other thing,
literally everything about the game that feels rushed from levels 1 to 50, uh-huh, because the game was rushed. It came out, it was horrible, and they redid it in like 2 years.
Yeah.
That all smooths out. So Heaven's Ward, they hired a bunch of new voice actors. Like half of the people from the first game, they got replaced, which I don't have opposition to. Some of them were pretty bad.
Some of them, I don't know if they were bad. You could just tell they were getting completely the wrong direction for their lines.
It was either they were bad, the direction was bad, or they did the entire thing in a single take and were just like, yeah, I mean,
ship it.
We got to have all this done today, so
yeah,
the Mass Effect Andromeda route.
Yeah,
exactly.
So I'm really having fun with Heaven's Ward. I think I'm decently far. I think I'm... My character is level 60, and I think I'm on main quest level of 56 or 58 or something like that. So yeah. I'm pretty deep in. It's really awesome. I'm having a ton of fun. I can't wait to get to the end game of this and do the new whatever the new raids are and dungeons and stuff, and then move on to Stormblood. So still just really enjoying Final Fantasy 14.
Yeah.
I played... After last week's episode, I think it was last week that I was on. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I played one run of Returnal. I'm not playing that game again.
Wait, yeah. one run as in one additional run.
No. So I had played like two and a half hours before last week's episode, and then I played one run, which took 2 hours.
That's too much for roguelike.
Last week, I was like, oh no, I think the runs are like 45 minutes. And then I believe you and Will were like, no, I think they're about 2 hours. Y'all were right. They're about 2 hours. That ain't okay with me. I already don't like roguelikes that much. So that is the nail in the coffin for me.
For a game that doesn't save as well. That just like,
yeah, that was,
that's too much.
It's not even so much that it saves as there's no like logical break point in
it.
Oh,
really? Because
like in a run, like there's different rooms, but there isn't like a story break. There isn't like an action break, mm-hmm. really. So like I think a lot of the stuff in the game is good, but not good enough to make up for what I think is a bad roguelike implementation. Like I think combat is fun. I think the art in the game is overall good. The enemies are relatively interesting. It is kind of a shmup, which makes sense for the developer, but
yeah.
Some of the weapon stuff, I'm like, why the hell can I only carry one weapon? Let me please just carry two.
Yeah.
Please, for the love of God, give me the handgun and another weapon.
I've said before, there's, and I'll say it again, I cannot wait to play this game when it hits PlayStation Plus or my local library. I'm going to love this game then when it costs me $0. Yeah. I will still probably get frustrated, but it's not $70 worth of frustration. It's just like free game frustration, you know?
That's pretty true. And I didn't play 70. It was like on sale for like 40 of like a month ago. So that's when I picked it up. But like, nice. Still too much for how much I spent. But it's very much the definition of mediocre for me, where it's like, I don't feel drawn enough to continue playing. But I don't hate the game. Like, I had fun with it. And I'm not like mad that I bought it. I was just kind of like,
it's not compelling.
It's not Final Fantasy 14.
You know, it's just not.
Well, it's not even.
It'll fall.
What other game is not? Death's Door, which is what I played after Returnal.
Really? Because I hear great, fantastic things about this.
Death's Door is great. Love Death's Door. So I bought that on Tuesday or Wednesday of this week, and I finished it on the same day.
What's the playtime? Let me...
I think it was about 6.5-7 hours for me to get
bad.
To the end. There is stuff you can do post-game. I'm probably not going to, but I had a lot of fun with the game. The combat is very smooth. I think it is, having played Hyperlight Drifter relatively recently for the first time, it feels like an evolution of Hyperlight Drifter, but from a different studio where
cool.
It's very Zelda-like, 2D Zelda-like, I should preface. It's very 2D Zelda-like, but actually has really good combat. The combat is really good. It has the Hyperlight Drifter system of you get a melee weapon and a ranged weapon / magic spell.
Mm-hmm.
And when you use your ranged weapon ammo or spell slots or whatever, once you start hitting things with your melee, those recharge, which is a fantastic system. I love that system. Please, more games steal that. Like, it is a good system. The art style is great. Honestly, the story was surprisingly good. It has good character design. There is a character later that just has like a hoodie, and saying his name would spoil it, but like he has just like a hoodie and a fanny Chad. Pack, and I'm like, this doesn't feel right, but also this is hilarious.
Yeah, I can't wait to dive into that. So do you know what's the systems that's out on? What's the cost?
Which?
So it is $20.
Okay.
Which for a, I felt for like a 7-ish hour game, that's perfectly reasonable.
Yeah.
And it is on, I believe, just Xbox and PC.
Oh.
Which for you, I think, is probably perfect because I believe you own both. So
I do, but I have some travel coming up, which I'm thinking about taking my Switch, and that would be great on Switch.
I'm like 90% sure it's not on Switch.
I'm reading something that says one of the creators said is there's no current plans that they can announce, but Switch is a very popular request for game developers these days. So
mm-hmm. I read that as Xbox probably gave them money to make this exclusive, and so we are not going to say whether it's coming to PlayStation or Switch. Yeah. I would be utterly flabbergasted if this did not come to the other consoles in 6 months to a year.
Yeah.
That would be an extreme mistake on their end in terms of making money.
Yeah.
But honestly, the game was super fun. I love the characters. I loved the combat. I loved it was probably the best 2D Zelda game I've played.
Wow.
And it's very blunt that it's from Zelda. Like, they have a whole they do some expectation subversion based on it being like Zelda. So if you've played the 2D Zeldas, there will be some things that you're like, oh, I've seen this before, and they know that you've seen it before, and they mess with you. So definitely it's fun. I had a good time with that. They had a good sense of humor. Good battle design too, and most of it was made by two people, which is also fantastic. They contracted like some art, and then a bunch of the publishing and QA stuff was contracted out, but primary development was like two people.
That's awesome.
Which is amazing for how good this game is.
I see another game on your list here, which I'm curious about because I believe this just hit Game Pass. Is that right?
So Boyfriend Dungeon came out yesterday. It was a shadow drop, so there was a Nintendo Indie World Showcase yesterday, and both Axiom Verge 2 and Boyfriend Dungeon got shadow dropped.
That's right. Yeah, I don't think it's on Game Pass. I think that was a mistake.
It is, so Boyfriend Dungeon is on Game Pass, they didn't say because it was at a Nintendo event, so they're not going to publicize that, but it is on Game Pass. That's where I'm playing it. It's on PC and console, so no worries there. It is a very fun dating sim with a dungeon crawler in it.
Wow.
So if you haven't seen this game, I actually played a demo of it, I think, in 2019 at a PAX or at E3. And the concept for the game is the people that you date in the dating sim part can turn into weapons that you then use in the dungeon crawler part.
That's good. That's good.
So, the way they balance the combat system of the game is that your damage is largely based off of your personal level. So you're like a wielder is what they call it. You're wielding the weapon people. So like your damage on different attacks is based on your personal level. Whereas the different abilities that the weapons have are based on you progressing in the dating sim portion of the game.
That's awesome.
Which is super cool. I'm having a ton of fun with it. This game is one of the horniest games I've ever seen. It's great. You converse with, it's a very modern too. So like there's texting, that's your main form of communication. And then you go on dates with various different people. You can be whatever gender you want. You can be male, female, non-binary. You can be, they don't restrict your dating choices based off of that. Game is super awesome. Inclusive in that respect. There are characters that are like clearly flamboyant. There are characters that are like polyamorous. There are characters that are monogamous, different pronouns, stuff. It's very cool. I can say as a freaking cis white dude, I've learned some things just by playing this game.
Cool.
And it is making me better at using correct pronouns and stuff, so I can also say that. So it is a fun time, and there's even a cat, which counts as dating, but also it's a cat, so dating.
Bring that up because I'm looking at the Wikipedia page for it right now, and it's a cat. Literally, there's the sentence is very strange. It says the weapons can be dated to increase their power, although the game contains a quote platonic unquote relationship with a cat.
You can also be platonic.
The quotes around platonic are giving me pause.
I'm not far enough yet with the cat to tell you where that goes.
Okay.
But I can also say that if you just want to be platonic with everyone, you can, and it just like you just learn more about them as people. So you're not limited by that stuff. It's generally, this game is just super well done. The combat could use a little work, especially coming straight off of Death's Door, like where combat is completely excellent. Mm-hmm. It's not as good in this game. And I think that's just because they also focused on the dating side and there's just not enough time to do all the things. But each weapon is also pretty darn unique. They have different effects. They have different attack patterns. Even there is one weapon that is a dagger that you attack with like four or five times in quick succession, do less damage. Mm-hmm. And then when you upgrade that relationship, when you dodge, it like confuses the enemy because you're supposed to be like roguelike and stealthy. There's other ones that are based on like big area damage. There's like a definitely not a lightsaber one that is like an electric thing, and like when you use a finisher, it stuns nearby enemies and stuff. So like each weapon has its own distinct powers and feel.
That's cool.
The cat weapon, my favorite so far.
What is it? Is it a whip?
It is brass knuckles with claws.
I was just about to say that. It's either a whip or it's claws.
It's brass knuckles with claws, but you like leap at enemies, which is not a thing for any of the other ones.
Ooh, that's
good. It's super cool. Like each weapon does feel like it fit, like the style feels like it fits the actual style of the weapon. Like there's a scythe that's a little slow but has like wide sweeping motions. Mm-hmm. There is an epee type of rapier, which is all very stabby, slim motions and sort of fast. So like they nailed that feel.
That's awesome.
So overall, I am having a great time with the game. I'm not done with it yet. I think I'm guessing I'm probably close to halfway. I don't have a playtime though, so I don't know how long that was, but I'm having a good time with it. I would 100% recommend it to anyone who's not like a giant homophobe. So
awesome.
And I honestly probably would recommend it to people who are homophobes, so they buy it.
They're the people who need it. That's awesome. That sounds like a great game people should check out. I've been playing
on Game Pass.
Yeah. Easy to try it on Game Pass. Mm-hmm. I've been playing, other than Final Fantasy XIV, literally the only other game I touched this past week was I played about 30 minutes of Microsoft Flight Simulator on the Xbox. It's on Xbox now.
Oh, that's right.
Trying out those updates. Right?
Yeah. So basically, they put it out on Xbox. I believe it's only on Series X, Series S. I don't think it's on Xbox One, which makes
sense.
You're
correct, yeah.
It's a very demanding game. They also put out a performance update to the PC. I don't know. I know Kyle played it, and it was very demanding. I have a 1080, which is an older card, but it's still pretty good. And Microsoft
I have a 2070 Super, and it was struggling a lot.
I was playing Microsoft Flight Simulator, 1080, a GTX 1080 at 1080p at low resolution, and I was getting about 25 FPS. Which is kind of understandable because that game looks phenomenal and it's streaming in, you know, Bing data. It's doing a lot of crazy stuff. But basically with this patch, I was running it at 60 FPS on the Series X at 4K, which is crazy. And I've heard you're not going to get 60 FPS 4K on your PC unless you have a super beefy rig. But I've heard people have gotten 20 plus FPS, which is crazy.
There's a problem. Reinstall it now.
Yeah. Reinstall it on PC though. And here's why.
Yeah.
The Xbox version, it reminds me a lot of like when a free-to-play game comes out and you boot the game up and you can immediately tell that it's a mobile game because of how the controls are set up.
Yeah.
Microsoft Flight Simulator, look, they did some stuff. I can't say they did nothing. But they might as well have done nothing to put this on console. Because literally when you boot the game up for a couple seconds, you see a mouse cursor in the top left. They did not change the UI at all. They just let you control a cursor with one of the sticks. And they did basic key binding for it. But it's literally just the PC version. And if you remember, the PC version like has a cool UI where you could be like, show me a map, pin it, drag the window over here. All of that is in here, but it's God awful to control with a controller.
Oh, that's a bummer.
Yeah, and like I just did the default 4K settings, and I have a 65-inch TV, and it was hard for me to read some of the text because the menus are still set for a PC, so it's just like tiny buttons, a lot of stuff on screen, and like literally like I mentioned how you could like pop out a window while you're flying and move it off to the side. To close that window, you have to hit the thumbstick to pop your cursor out and then move to the X in the top right of that window to X out of it. It's just like they did not do enough at all to make this good on the controller, and it's completely UI. The flying is fine on the controller. They even did some cool stuff where it's like they have like a system sub menu, so you have like your normal buttons and then you hold down the right bumper and then you can then the buttons become something else to do systems like setting your flaps and your trim and all that. But my God, is that UI just god awful on a controller. Absolute shit.
Yeah, that's a bummer.
On the PC release, I used the combo of my 360 for flight controls and then mouse and keyboard for everything else. And
yeah,
it's ideal. I can't imagine relegating everything just to the controller. Like it's just not enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like you could totally do it if you reworked the UI, which they should have done, especially since this console release is, I think it's more than a year.
It's about a year, maybe it's had more
the PC. Yeah, so it's like it's just because the thing is, I want to play this game, but I realized I packed my flight joystick like 3 weeks ago. I think it's actually in Florida already, so I can't even dig it out. So I'm literally like, okay, well, if I'm gonna play with the controller, I might as well play it on the Series X, right? And I only played 25 minutes of it because it was literally just like, you did not do enough. This feels like god awful just trying to navigate these menus with the controller. That's a big shame.
That's such a bummer. Yeah.
Speaking of bummers, but also, oh boy, good news. Let's go to the news.
Here's the news. We're talking about news. It's gaming news. What's up, news?
Thank you, Zach. It's crazy. He, like, one of these days, I expect him to not be available to hop on and sing the song live, but he's there always.
You know, he's so spot on every time.
It's crazy.
Every time.
It's crazy.
Same key, same volume. Amazing.
Yeah.
He's a pro. We're going to try something a little different, which is I put these news stories in order. So let's talk about this first one. This Grand Theft Auto 3 Vice City and San Andreas remaster rumor, kind of confirmed by Kotaku. What do you guys know about this story, and or are you excited for these remakes or remasters?
I saw that they're not remaking it in the whatever the engine is that they make like Red Dead in. It's whatever Rockstar's normal engine is. They're doing an Unreal Engine, which I thought was interesting. I'm a fan. You know, it's been a really long time since I played Vice City, and I don't think I've ever played any of the other ones, so I'm interested. As long as the price is right, you know, I'm down.
Yeah, this I was literally, I never really played Vice City except for like booting it up and messing around a little bit. I played maybe the first third of Grand Theft Auto 3, and I played maybe the first couple missions of San Andreas. And literally just weeks ago, and it happens every couple months, I go, maybe I should play Vice City. Maybe I should play San Andreas. But it's kind of hard to go back to it because they have mobile ports, but apparently they're awful. Plus, you'd be playing it on mobile.
Yeah. I mean, the controls already weren't good back then. And to be fair, I don't even think GTA 5's controls are good modern day.
That's fair.
So for me, I played the majority of Vice City. I didn't beat it. And then I played the entirety of San Andreas. And I think I played part of 3.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't... Basically, these are supposed to be coming out this year from what the rumor's saying, too.
I think it was September, October time frame, I believe.
Yeah, that's a bad time. There are a lot of games coming out that are new. And
too. Yeah.
Just in general, there's a ton of cool stuff coming out this year. Really, leading up to the holidays, there's a ton of stuff almost every week starting next week. And this just doesn't do it for me. If it were like remastered in the GTA 5 or Red Dead engine, looks like a modern day GTA 5, yeah, I might pick these up like later in the year, like once Christmas or something comes around and I've finished off the other games, but it doesn't sound like that's the goal here. They're saying it's going to be a weird mix of new and old art style. I don't know what that means. I need to see that before I'm like, this is fine. Yeah.
So I've got some quotes here from this Kotaku article. Quote, all three of the games are being remastered using Unreal Engine and will be a mix of new and old graphics. One source who claims to have seen a snippet of the games in action said that the visuals reminded them of a heavily modded version of a classic GTA title. The UI for the games are being updated too, but will retain the same classic style. Another quote here, Kotaku has been told that these remastered titles are trying to stay true to the PS2 era GTA games as much as possible, end quote. So I'm wondering if that means kind of a visual uplift and a UI rework slightly, but I'm worried, like you said, the controls, they've got to do some work there, and I'm not really feeling it from that description. But then again, these are rumors, so
We'll see. I'm not exceptionally hyped having played these already. Like, I might touch them end of this year, early next year, if they are good remakes, but...
Yeah. So here's the thing. The rumor is the remastered trilogy, it will be one purchase. So let's say $60-$70 and you get all three together.
For that price tag, I'm out.
I'd pay $60 for three. It's digital only.
For all three, I would do it. Yeah.
It's coming PS4, PS5, Xbox One, Xbox Series X, S, Switch, PC, Stadia, and mobile phones. However, it looks like the PC and mobile ports are probably going to slip to next year because they're focusing on the console ports first. So I don't know. There's a lot to love in this, but there's a lot to be hesitant about.
The fact that it's even supposed to run on mobile makes me suspect.
But Fortnite,
even if it's delayed,
runs on mobile.
Yeah, I mean, mobile processors, and? Especially like Apple, is like really. I don't know.
But actually, I mean,
like, Fortnite, for their older games,
like Fortnite supports ray tracing, and it also runs on mobile, and it's on Unreal Engine, so.
In the mobile version, it does not support ray tracing.
That's true. But I just mean, I'm Unreal Engine is probably the only engine
it
I can
think
be of
done, yeah.
where. It has enough of a wide swath that I don't think you would be gimped too much by a mobile version.
It could. I don't think I trust Rockstar with
that's
this.
Fair. That's fair.
Did they say who's actually working on it? Like, is Rockstar doing this themselves?
It's Rockstar Dundee, who is the Scottish studio that they just picked up, who did work on Crackdown 2, Crackdown 3, Master Chief Collection, if you remember them.
Okay. Well,
Master Chief Collection was great, so.
Not at first, so.
Yeah,
I mean, there were little problems, but nothing like terrible.
You know, I'm gonna say Crackdown 3.
The PC version had a lot of problems, but
Crackdown 3, not a bad game.
I never had any problems on PC with Halo when it first came out. I know that other people did, but I never experienced any.
So basically, it's that offshoot studio that's handling this, and they have port and remaster work in the past. Yeah. So let's just go around. It sounds like David, $60, all three. You would not purchase it. Maybe later.
Maybe later, but definitely not the start.
Yeah, I think, you know, for me, I'm hesitant only just because I'm starting to think now about the calendar. It really depends where it lands. If it lands kind of by itself compared to other games that I would purchase and buy, then yeah, I may pick it up. What about you, Kyle?
Yeah, it's not at the top of my list or anything, but I would be interested in playing it if it's good, if it's, you know, the reviews come out and it's a quality port or remaster, I guess. I would be interested. But yeah, $60 for three fully fledged games, regardless of the fact that they're older, like, yeah. I don't know, I'd be down. But yeah, it's not going to take precedence over like a new game that I'm already anticipating.
Absolutely. So let's move on to some good news, folks. Ladies and gentlemen, Knuckles is sexy. That's right. Idris Elba officially cast as Knuckles in the Sonic the Hedgehog 2 movie. Are you guys as crazy excited about this as I am?
Yes. Idris Elba makes everything better.
Oh, he's so good.
Crazy excited, but hell yeah.
Hell yeah. Yeah.
That's all I have on this, is just hell yeah, let's go.
Man, did you guys watch the first movie?
Yeah,
I didn't know.
It wasn't bad.
It was fine. Yeah.
Yeah. There are definitely worse blockbuster movies out there, and there are definitely worse video game movies out there. So I'm excited for this one. It's going to be crazy to have Knuckles in it.
Can you watch the first one streaming yet?
Probably.
Yeah. It's okay. I think it's
I'm going to give it a while.
No, actually, you could, because it came out Valentine's Day, and then the pandemic happened, and they pretty quickly turned it around, and I paid $20 to watch it, like, the first week of the pandemic, because they released it early digital. Yeah. Worth it, honestly, 100%.
Okay.
Let's move on to this next news story. This is kind of a crazy one. Did you guys hear about this? Where basically some of the court documents coming out of, I believe this is the Epic Apple lawsuit, revealed that Google considered buying Epic Games when they first started looking into the gaming industry. Did you guys hear about this one?
So I completely misread this title and thought that they were currently interested in, but I was like, well, that's one way to end a lawsuit. I guess it does make sense to me that they, I mean, Google buys so much. It would make sense to me that they would scope out, you know, this then much smaller company and be like, maybe this will turn into something you know, bigger with us behind it. But I feel like there's stuff like that. I mean, Apple has, the amount of stuff that Apple has almost bought is like crazy. So Google's got to be even more.
I was going to say, Google has like hundreds of times more money than Smaug. Like, of course they want to just buy this and make it go away. Because they're going to be affected by the outcomes of this lawsuit too. So why not just keep status quo, drop a few few billion dollars, acquire Epic Games, and keep all the rest of your money in your mountain.
Yeah. So I'm actually digging into this story, and the way it sounds like is, if you remember a quick debrief on the Epic lawsuit, is basically Epic does not like the pay cut that Apple and Google take out of Fortnite mobile. And there was some negotiations going on between Epic and Google as to that cut and availability, etc. And it was during those negotiations that internally Google looked at, how about we stop negotiating with them and just buy them away? Like, literally just buy them, and they can't deal with us anymore. So that's crazy.
The world of business, man.
This lawsuit, honestly, it's great because of all these documents that are coming out in the court.
Yep.
Just insane.
There's, I mean, if you subscribe to, well, I guess either the Google subreddit and the Apple subreddit will have both, but the Apple subreddit specifically has had so many releases of emails between CEOs, and it's just really funny to see how Tim Cook handles stuff. There's even, I mean, there's some stuff that goes back to when Jobs was still there, and like, just the tone that some of these people take is just incredible.
Yeah. But yeah. It's always crazy at work when I end up interacting a little bit with like the executive level, and it's just like, it's just a lot of like emails, like, I don't want to say carefully worded emails, but a lot of people's jobs, and this is not to say they're not doing a job, it's to literally just step in and be like, hey, can you take care of this? And then they just sign it CEO, and you're like, okay, all right, this is my priority now. And you know,
well, and I've been in some email and personal chains where we've been talking to a vendor or something that's like a lot smaller than us, my previous job. And they'll be like, I mean, yeah, but how much would it cost to just buy them? Okay. All right. This is where this is going. All right, cool.
Yeah.
So this is not shocking, but it is funny.
Yeah, it's crazy. So another crazy story. I don't know if you guys, do you guys know about the problems that Apex Legends and Titanfall have been having lately?
Yeah, isn't there been a lot of like DDoS attacks?
Yeah,
Like specifically with that, and it seems like Respawn has not been doing much.
Well, yeah. Well, so David, it looks like you may seemed know a
like
bit more.
That. You know a little more on it. Like, I know I heard that it was an elaborate plot that like rivals some mystery novels in terms of the amount of crazy shit that's happening in it.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, hold on. Before you go any further, does this have anything to do with what happened on the Titanfall subreddit?
Well, what was on the Titanfall subreddit?
Apparently, I obviously was in Japan and not fully paying attention to everything, but I went on Reddit one day, and the Titanfall 2 subreddit changed overnight from like, this is a subreddit about the game, and you know, if you have problems like contact support or whatever, to there was a post that someone made about, I don't know if it was about Respawn, but it was like a spy thriller. Like, that's what it turned into, and people, it like the entire subreddit blew up. So I don't know if this has anything to do with that, but it sounds like it could. Oh. Okay.
Well, please, I believe the spy thriller is the story of how the Titanfall devs found these hackers.
Oh, yeah.
And who the hackers are.
So basically,
please tell me the story.
So again, this is very rough understanding, and a lot of this is accusatory. I don't think any of this has been proven, but essentially, Titanfall has been under a lot of DDoS attacks lately. People believe it could be a protest, like people saying, hey, the state of the game is not great, and you need to pay attention to it, and because of that, we're going to bring the server down, you know, almost as a hostage attempt. There are other parties who were trying to basically save Titanfall. They were saying, they were like, hey, we're going to try and stop these DDoS attacks. We're going to save Titanfall. We're the good guys in the community. And then at the same time, there's a third party which is trying to make their own, I believe it's called, they're trying to revive the canceled spinoff Titanfall Online as a fan project. And so basically, there's unknown hackers who keep DDoSing. There's white hat hackers who are like, we're going to try and protect and figure out who these people are. And then there's people on the side who are like, let's make this Titanfall Online. Turns out the accusation is that they're all the same people, that they're literally just trying to DDoS Titanfall and turn the community against Titanfall and the Titanfall devs so that they can get promotion and players for their own Titanfall Online project. So, and Respawn's just stuck in the middle because they're literally just going, these idiots keep DDoSing our own servers, and we can't, it's very hard to protect against that unless you just start literally throwing money at more and more servers, etc. And they're just like, we know you love the game. We want you to play the game. We're trying to help against these DDoS, and it turns out it's just the community itself DDoSing the game. It's just this stupid, stupid thing.
It sounds like these people have played Eve before and are like, yes, used to subterfuge, and are just like, let's move on to a different game. Pick one at random. Random Titanfall. Let's
exactly.
Go for it.
And then the other thing is, they moved on to Apex. They feel like the DDoS individuals, they felt like they weren't getting enough attention, so they moved on to DDoSing Apex, which is now affecting them.
I like Apex, though.
Yeah.
Apex
is fun. So that's the crazy thing. And then I believe there was a story today about the one of the lead designers for Apex was fired for sexual harassment. So.
No, not sexual harassment. Different.
Oh, it was different.
He was removed for essentially blog posts he wrote years and years ago,
right,
and never
yes.
took down, that involved saying
very
that he had
content. Yeah,
some inappropriate content that I'm not even comfortable like quoting
to.
Here.
Yes.
Yeah, there was some.
It was like
some
racist
stuff.
Sexist stuff.
There was some very sexist stuff, and this guy. He originally, I believe, worked at Riot Games.
Not surprising then.
And well, he got fired because he was very vocal online on Reddit, on Twitter, and all these things, and was saying a lot of things that he was not authorized to say. And eventually, like, they gave him a lot of leeway. And at one point, I don't remember exactly what incident caused it, but they were like, "Nope, sorry, you went too far. Like, you're gone." And he's also been doing that for Apex Legends recently. Like, he's been very vocal on Reddit, on Twitter, like combative with the community. And I think that I imagine he was already on watch for that stuff. Like,
yeah.
Respawn was like, dude, please stop. We already had Vince Cimpella have to put an apology message out for other devs who were getting like criticized on Reddit and stuff. Like, we don't need more of this. And then they found, some community members found these blog posts that for some reason he hadn't fucking deleted. And they were horrible. It's like still sitting on DeviantArt after like almost 15 years. And
oh,
he had never removed it. Yeah. It was blogs on DeviantArt that had been there for almost 15 years that were like hyper racist. And it wasn't something he wrote as a teenager. He was like almost 30 at the time.
Yeah.
Pro tip, everyone. If you're a racist, don't put it on the internet.
Yeah, don't put it on the internet.
Just don't.
Also,
well,
just
unless you're
thing,
like
if,
really committed to it. If you're going to make your whole life about that,
just in general, if you, because like I'm not going to put it above people or below people. Like, you can be racist and stop being racist. Like, that can happen.
Oh yeah.
When you do, you should go back and remove the things that no longer represent your current views.
Yep. 100%.
You're an idiot if you don't do that.
Yeah.
And negligent, in my opinion. Like, that's just stupid. So, yeah, he got fired.
Yeah.
And good luck getting another job, but also it's the gaming industry. People will forget in a month and you'll get a job. So
exactly. Yeah, it's just
Blizzard, it'll be fine.
Yeah. There's a lot of like toxic communities, but I don't want to say this is the worst, but to have a community that loves this old niche game, Titanfall 1, so much that they somehow convince themselves that they need to deliberately attack the game in such a way that people can't play it.
I wouldn't call that a community. That's like a cabal of a dozen people.
That's fair. That's still just crazy, crazy. Let's go to a story that's honestly not that crazy, but we should talk about it. The Sony acquisition of Crunchyroll is complete for $1.175 billion. Y'all like anime, right? Anime good.
I'm a weeb, yeah.
Yeah,
anime good. I think this is worth bringing up just because there are rumors, and I would not be surprised if this happens, that they're going to offer some sort of bundle where it's going to be PlayStation Plus plus Crunchyroll Premium, etc. And I mean, that'd be cool.
Listen, I pay for both of these things. Do you want a bundle and make them cheaper? I'm on board.
Yeah, exactly. I don't pay for Crunchyroll, but if you're gonna give it to me for free, then I would watch a lot more Crunchyroll, you know.
Listen, the rumor is that the bundle will cost more than base PlayStation Plus.
Oh, that's probably the rumor.
As long as they call it PlayStation Crunch, I'm down.
That's good. Golden.
Shortly on our own SaveData content, we were talking about Weeb Station Plus, which is also good.
Weeb Station Plus, I like that.
Turn around, Kyle, go back to Japan. You got to work for somebody with mine like that.
Listen, like I pay for Crunchyroll, Funimation, and PlayStation Plus right now.
Yeah,
I'll take cheaper.
Put it together.
Yeah,
put it together. Speaking of good stuff, let's talk about the Amiga 500 is returning as a mini console. Guys, are you guys as in love with mini consoles as I am?
I don't care at all.
There's been so much more. Like, there's been so many over the past, I feel like even just the past 2 years. I don't have any, but I think they're cool. I have no need for them. But as like a novelty item or something, even just to have like, I don't know, in your collection, like I think they're pretty sweet.
Yeah,
let me rephrase. Some of them are okay. I wouldn't put the Amiga 500 on that list, or like the Commodore 64 ones on that list.
Well, let me pitch this to you, and then we'll try and put an imaginary price on it because the price hasn't been announced at which you would buy it. Okay, so it is the Amiga 500. It's scheduled for release in early 22. It will emulate both the original A500 and the Amiga 1200. You're going to be able to select from 25 games that can be accessed through a virtual carousel loaded onto the console. It has USB functionality and will allow you to load additional games onto the console. It's got some built-in features like choose the screen refresh rate, 50 or 60 hertz, CRT filter, scaling options, etc. So it's kind of a basic mini. At what price would you guys buy this?
Having literally zero experience with an Amiga, I wouldn't.
You're a real fucking downer over there.
What is a comparable price for something like what you have some of these? I'm assuming.
Yeah, NES Mini was, or sorry, NES Classic, $60. SNES Classic was $80. The PlayStation, I believe, was either $80 or $70.
I think the PlayStation 1 came out at 80, no one bought it, and then they dropped it to 60 or 70.
You can literally buy it for like $20 now. I think pretty quickly dropped.
I mean, like, they dropped it like within the first month. It was fast. Yeah.
I mean, just because I think it's way more niche, obviously, than like a Nintendo or a Sony console. Yeah. I'm thinking like $40, like 45.
That's what I was thinking.
Somewhere around there.
I was thinking that. Because as somebody who...
I think that's a fair price. I'm just not the target for this.
Yeah.
Because I we got some time here. I've got the NES Classic. I got the SNES Classic. I've got the Genesis Mini. Some of these names, I don't know the actual name, but I've got the Neo Geo one, which is like a little arcade cabinet, which is kind of cool. I have a fake NES Classic, a fake SNES Classic. So I have seven. I'm probably... Did I say PlayStation? I didn't say PlayStation. So I think I have eight. And I'm not even a collector. It's just like, if it's the right price, I'll buy it. Because even the PlayStation 1, I bought it at $60 because it had 20 games on it. And I was like, at some point, I'm going to mod more on here. And it plays PlayStation, so it was cool.
Yeah. I guess from my perspective, if I'm gonna go out, none of them had enough games or enough games that I was interested in to want to pay that much money for. And when the solution is modding it and putting ROMs on it, why am I not just doing that on a PlayStation or a PSP that I already have, or a Switch or something that I already have? So that's my logic behind it. So it's like, if there were literally like the perfect mini console where the PlayStation 1 had all of my favorite games from PS1 on it, yeah, I would have dropped $60-$80 on that, sure.
So
yeah.
is there just like a flash storage on these things where that's typically where everything is stored, and it runs much like Linux or some sort of
light? And they're usually they're powered by USB, so they literally just have a USB port. So like when they come out, you just wait a week or two and somebody figures out how to crack it, and then you can just load as many ROMs on it as you want.
It's actually a pretty, I mean, I don't have any, like I said, but it's actually a pretty interesting way of having a version of physical media.
Yes,
like like having it stored somewhere that's playable. Like that's an interesting take on like archiving stuff.
Exactly, with accurate controllers and HDMI out, which is like I've been diving a little bit into the classic console scene just because it's a waste of money, but I like having them because I never had them, and it's the type of thing where it's like, if you want for me to get an SNES HDMI output with pretty good quality, I basically spent $230 on top of the SNES. You can do it for cheaper, but the quality is not great. But having this, like the SNES Classic, where it's just like, I can throw any SNES ROM I want on here, and I get a really clean HDMI out, and I get to use basically a SNES controller, that it's very cool for that. So yeah, I think I agree. That $40 to $60 range is real nice.
You know what would get me? An Atari one. That would get me.
There you go. Aren't they coming out with something?
They have the
VCS. I don't know.
They have the VCS, they decided, but it's a god awful console. Do not touch it. It's like $400.
Yeah,
they
decided to make like a $400 console and a hotel over making a mini Atari,
and a speaker hat.
They're idiots.
100%.
They're absolute idiots. But like, that's the one where I have issues setting it up because it is so old that I don't. There aren't even component cables. Like it's antenna cable.
Yeah.
So for consoles that old, I would buy a mini console just because. Like, I still have my Super Nintendo. It still works.
Yeah.
I can still plug it into my TV with a minimal amount of effort.
Yeah.
I cannot easily plug in my Atari 7200. I think that's what it is. I haven't even been able to get to work on my TV without a ton of effort. So put that in a mini console.
It's crazy, though, because honestly, one of the reasons why I keep buying these things, and part of the reason why I'm buying a house, is because I'm slowly collecting it, but like, for example, I have a Genesis Mini and I have a Genesis, and being able to have them next to each other is really cool, but I don't have room to display them. So now with a new house, I literally just have a gaming room where I'm just going to have like the Mini and the normal. It's like, I played them twice, but they look so freaking cool next to each other, you know, just stupid stuff.
Like I need a place to display this Genesis Mini. I'm going to buy a whole house to display it.
There have been worse decisions made. I think that's super valid. So.
Speaking of stupid stuff, all of us should probably buy. Let's talk about Pepsi and Samuel Adams teaming up to create Hard Mountain Dew. It will contain 5% alcohol. It's launching in early 2022. Let me just open this picture and read these flavors. It's Hard Mountain Dew Zero Sugar, Hard Mountain Dew Black Cherry Zero Sugar, Hard Mountain Dew Watermelon Zero Sugar. Are you guys excited to drink this? Because I think I just want to try it, you know.
I'm excited to go to my local mixologist and start asking for this stuff.
Yeah.
Do you guys have the Mountain Dew Hard seltzer?
The crazy thing is, I'm pretty sure these are not gonna have caffeine in them, because
you said one was sugar free, right?
Yeah, it just says sugar free, but the thing
they're all sugar free, yeah.
But okay. I feel like after the Four Loko craze, I don't know if you're allowed to have caffeine and alcohol together in a single drink.
You might be right, but also I don't care, and I'm gonna get a variety of pack of these when these come out.
I know.
I'm gonna put them behind me for my streams, you know, just in case. Just in case I need something to pick me up.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Here it is. This is an article from 2010, U.S. banned sale of alcoholic drinks with caffeine kick. So assuming this is still in effect 11 years later.
I won't have caffeine.
Yeah.
Listen, I like the taste of Mountain Dew, so I'm still going to buy these.
I know. I it's a little weird though because they have black cherry and watermelon flavors, but really I want Code Red and I want a Baja Blast.
Let's be real, black cherry is just Code Red. Like,
oh really? Is that what that flavor is? I never thought about cherry. It that way.
Code Red is cherry. Yeah.
Oh, I never thought about it that way. That's a good
point. I actually had an experience in Tokyo with Mtn Dew. I'm a type 1 diabetic, so my blood sugar is very dependent on like carbs, sugar intake. And I was coming back from that town I was telling you about where I got the green tea, and I had a low blood sugar. I was in the train station waiting for my train, and I was like, oh crap, my like blood sugars are going low. I do not drink like normal like soda. It has to be diet, or it has to be like Coke Zero or something. And I was never a big fan of Mtn Dew. And there was one of the billions of vending machines that are wonderful everywhere in Japan, or at least in Tokyo. And they had a Mtn Dew. And I was like, oh, a Japanese version of Mtn Dew, or just a Japanese can that I can get. And I bought it. It was like 120 yen. And I have not, again, haven't had Mtn Dew in probably like 15 years. It was really good.
I know. I had some for dinner.
It was really good.
When I go to Costco, I get a hot dog and a Mtn Dew, and it's real good.
Well, it's like that's the problem now, because normal Coke to me tastes just, it's way too sugary. It's 100%. Way too overpowering. But this is like dangerous, because if I drink it, my sugar is going to go up like real fast, but it tastes real good.
Yeah.
So I'm sort of at a crossroads.
I think
now.
They sell a zero sugar Mtn Dew. I'm pretty
they
sure
do. They might. But the other thing is, like, I love Taco Bell, and I've always just not gotten Baja Blast because
Baja
it's not
Blast,
like,
though.
Yeah. But now I'm like, I gotta try Baja Blast. Gotta get now, that so.
Baja Blast Freeze. Oh, yeah. For a while they had a strawberry Starburst Freeze at Taco Bell, and it was incredible. I would take it home, and I'm just gonna go on a little story tangent. I was working on my Miata, and I put a new exhaust on it, and the exhaust looked really good, but if you touch it when you're putting it on, and then you turn it on for the first time, it burns the fingerprints into the exhaust, because it's like a chrome exhaust. And so they're like, you need to wipe it down with vodka. Like, basically, you wipe it down with vodka after you install it, and then you turn it on, and it burns clean. And I was like, okay, and I went to the store, and I was like, well, I guess I should just buy this like $5 handle of vodka. So then I only used a little bit of Everclean. So I had this giant handle of vodka. Basically, every Sunday for like a year, I'd go to Taco Bell, get like $20 worth of food and one of their freezes, and I'd come home and I'd put vodka in it, and I'd have a real good Sunday, folks. It was the best.
I'm gonna have to follow your lead doing that.
Dude, I might have to run to a Taco Bell this Sunday and get a Baja Blast freeze.
Yes.
It's so funny it was Sunday, because Sundays were my Taco Bell days, like out of the entire week. It's D&D Sundays, and like that's just what I did.
Yeah,
it's great.
Speaking of great, let's talk about Call of Duty Vanguard with our Call of Duty expert, Kyle. Have you seen this leak? I think it came out. This is 12 hours ago.
Today or yesterday?
Yeah, there was like some test footage or something that leaked. Or yeah, I saw it on the gaming subreddit. I get most of my news from Reddit, so apologies for constantly referencing it. I guess it's just what they're doing. Like, I'm not like interested. I don't care. I really have not played Warzone in a very long time, and all this, you know, Fallout with Activision and Bobby Kotick and Blizzard and all that shit. I just don't care to support them at the moment.
Yeah.
So that's true. as much as I'm sure Raven is hoping that
Sledgehammer is this one,
or Sledgehammer, sorry, I thought again. I don't know. I'm sure that they're as far as like their core audience is concerned, like they're just going to go out and buy the game or whatever's released, they'll get their base amount of audience that will go out and buy it. But I do hope that like something changes with Activision. Just speaking to a larger thing with Activision, but I don't care about Call of Duty right now, and I just don't, doesn't matter.
Also, I might be wrong on this. Didn't the title of this game leak last year when it got delayed to this year?
Someone in the comments said that, oh, this person said that this was the title like a while ago, and then we looked this, they like linked to their comment and everybody started upvoting. And
I was gonna say, I remember this being like last year, people were like, oh, Sledgehammers is Vanguard and it's gonna be World War II, but it got delayed and now they have to push up Cold War with Treyarch and Raven doing double time on it.
Yeah. The other thing that was in those early rumors, not in this rumor, is that it's World War II alternate history 50s, where World War II is still ongoing. And this rumor makes it sound like it's not. It's just normal World War II.
I don't think it's that clear.
Yeah, it's not clear yet, but it's like, it's one of those things where it's like that alternate history 50s was literally the only thing making me even remotely interested in it. Yeah, so if they're not going to do that. Cool.
I know they hired some pretty interesting writers for this one, so
it could be interesting.
Hopefully it's alternate.
I will 50s. Say this. That'd be cool. I fell off Call of Duty a long time ago. I played Cold War. Like, literally the only reason why I bought Cold War because I heard it was really cool on the PS5's DualSense control triggers, which it was.
Yeah.
And the crazy thing about Cold War was that the story wasn't great, but it did some crazy stuff at the end. Like, the story goes off the rails at the end, and then it literally has a decision that changes how the game ends. Can I just spoil Cold War for you guys real quick?
I mean, I don't care.
2 hours into it, and I'm not going to finish it. So please, by all means.
So it's just like, hey, it's like the 70s or 80s. It's the 80s, and you're on this like CIA team, and you're trying to hunt down this guy who's like, remember he was in Vietnam, remember he did this stuff, and like, so you like, part of it is flashbacks where they're like, hey, remember when we did that mission in Vietnam? You remember how it went? And you do the mission, and then part of it's the future. Anyways, you realize towards the end that. I'm going to call him Robert Redford because it's basically Robert Redford who's like your handler and he's leading your team of CIA guys. You find out at the end that you're actually a Russian agent who was captured by the CIA and brainwashed into thinking that you're a CIA operative and you're on their team. And when you're replaying their missions, they're really just like... you're like in a brainwashing state, and they're like trying to talk you into revealing information about the guy you used to work with, and like, so like the second to last mission is literally just them talking to you, like talking you through the Vietnam mission, and he's just like, do you remember there was a bridge, and you go up to the bridge, and then there's a path to the right, and you go down the right, and you hear him go, no, he's going the wrong way, and then like the mission like fades to black, and it pops back up, and he goes, okay, now remember, go down the bridge, and you go down the bridge, but then you like start seeing your face on all the enemies, and it's this really, really trippy, like,
that's mission. Actually really cool.
I know, right? Yeah. And then so then after that, after you realize what's going on, they basically sit you down there like, look, you used to work for this guy, but you're a good guy now, right? Are you gonna help us? And they literally give you a choice where it's just like, tell them the correct information or tell them the wrong information. And I was like, tell them the wrong information. So I told them the wrong information. They're just like, we're going to go get this guy. We're going to take care of him before he like nukes the entire world. Cause that's his plan, is to like nuke the whole world. So you like land in Chernobyl with your team, and you're just like, yeah, let's go. And you start walking down the street, and then the enemy shows up and they pull out all these guns, and they're just like, come on, comrade. And you like turn around, and you're just like, I'm on their side now. And then the mission is literally just hunt down your characters that you have been on a team with and have seen in all the cutscenes for the rest of the game. So the game just ends with you like hunting down Robert Redford and gunning him down. And then they just nuke the world. And it's like, and that's a choice. You could have chosen to not do that. Yeah, that's why I was like, this game is so mediocre, boring. And then those last two things just blew my mind. So that's the only thing that makes me even slightly interested in Call of Duty going forward, is I want more stuff like that going on in it.
It's crazy. Robert Redford.
Yeah. It's crazy. Let's we've got some final stories here. Any of these stories at the end you guys want to shout out or talk about real quick? This is kind of the fluff at the bottom.
Let's see.
I'll just go through them real quick. Somebody modded a PS2 into a handheld, and the interesting way they did it was they actually cut the circuit board of the PS2 into multiple pieces and then had to hand solder the connections back together for the leads that they cut through, which is pretty crazy. Cookie Clicker is getting a Steam remaster. Did you guys ever play Cookie Clicker?
I did. This is stupid.
You're an idiot. It's incredible. It's one of the few really good early idler games. Google.
The fact that it's like $10 is what's stupid.
Yeah. That's. I'll pay him anyways. He deserves the money. Google may start licensing out its Stadia game streaming platform to industry partners. So there are basically some rumors talking about how they may eventually take down Stadia, and instead of selling it as Google Stadia, they would just sell the tech out to other developers, etc.
Yeah, I just assumed that's what they would do when it failed.
Yeah, yeah, that just you can tell they are not committed to this at all, because it's like there's a clear path forward here, which is like subscription service and pad out the library.
Yeah. Listen, and,
oh god,
if I'm Sony, I'm waiting for Stadia to just fireball into dust,
yeah,
and then be like, hey, fire sale on all those servers and GPUs and everything, yeah, so we can set up our streaming thing. Cool, thanks.
So we can make PS Now better. Yeah,
yeah. So I'm assuming that's what's going to happen. Yeah, we'll see.
So a little bit of a rumor about the upcoming unconfirmed Firaxis Marvel XCOM game, which is that they will let you make your own superheroes instead of using pre-mades like Captain America, etc. That could be pretty exciting. And finally, Dr. Disrespect is starting his own game development studio. We got some hints from a job posting, which basically talks about how this development studio will team up with major influencers to make their own games. So we're going to have Pokimane's Pokemon knockoff coming out soon, for example. This is a god-awful idea, right?
Oh, I interpreted it differently. But either way, the guy behind Dr. Disrespect is a douchebag. So yeah. No.
Yep.
Like he is the definition of what is wrong with game developers, with Activision and Blizzard and stuff. So no, I'm good. Hard pass. Yep. I will not play anything that he makes.
Exactly.
Anything that specifically references influencers is already.
I mean, that's normal in game marketing now. That's
no, like, I mean, specifically, well, okay, so I only say that because back when we worked at Gamumentary, we did a documentary on Outpost Games, and their whole thing was partnering with influencers and streamers and popular celebrities, and that game ended up in a big fireball. So I tend not to, to go for studios that are like, this is one of our core things that we're going to be doing. So... yeah.
That being said, if any studios want to hit us up as core influencers, give us money.
Right,
we have gotten codes before and covered it, so there's a very tiny silver lining. Very, very tiny. Well, folks, here it is. That's going to do it for this episode of Local Chat. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Sorry, I'm just checking stuff. If you like our content, you can find us at subpixelfilms.com. Kyle, we can find you at Kyle of the Beard, and David, we can find you at Mizuki13 on Twitter. Is that right?
You can, but just go to Save Data Team everything.
Go to Save Data
Team. I don't post anything on Twitter.
You can find out their fantastic content, and you can find us at Subpixel Team on Twitter, Facebook, Twitch, Instagram, and TikTok. We're going to be streaming on Saturday. It's going to be a solo stream with me. Honestly, there's a Back for Blood open beta, and I was like,
oh, that's right.
No, I'm just going to play Final Fantasy 14 by myself because that's the game I really want to play. So be on the lookout for that Saturday. I may do it during the day. Be a little bit easier for me. Thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining. It's been an incredible episode. And you know what? This is easy. I'm just going to do this from now on. Will's not allowed back. I don't even know where he is. He's in the wild. Thank you guys for watching. Bye-bye.
Bye.